Welcome to It's Your Date with Destiny with Apostle Vivian and Pastor Gemma Duncan of Divine Destiny Worship Center in Diego Martin. For the next 30 minutes, join us as we take you on a journey of maximizing your potential and realizing your goals through Jesus Christ.
Why is it when you need a miracle, it doesn't happen, but when you least expect it, it happens?
You are married. You have challenges in your relationship, but your spouse is unwilling to accede to any counseling. Is divorce an option?
How does a parent handle a promiscuous child?
What are considered the do's and don'ts of a born-again couple who is not yet married?
There are always more questions than answers. So here is Apostle Gemma.
A very good morning to you. Welcome to Ask Pastor Gemma. Thank you so much for taking the time to be with me this morning. In the event that you're a first-time viewer, my name is Gemma Duncan. I'm married to Apostle Vivian Duncan, and we pastor Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our headquarters is located on the Diego Martin Main Road, opposite Sardonyx Drive. We have branches in Sandy Grande. We have one in Chaguanas, in Rio Claro. Faisabad, we have a branch in Tobago, and one in Antigua, in the event that you have a friend or a family member there. This morning, I want to continue with the response to the question, how do I know I am really born again? It's a term that we use in full gospel churches, and many people are puzzled by the term, simply because people have the impression that we use the term to turn us into an exclusive club. But the truth is, the full gospel churches did not initiate the term born again. They were the exact words of Jesus Christ. If you look at the Bible, and I'm going to read it in a little bit, in John chapter 3, verse 3, you will see that the words are in red. And if you have a Bible with the words in red, all of Jesus' words are in red. The term born again was, it's scriptural, it's biblical, it's Jesus who initiated it. I still want to update you with the notices from Divine Destiny Worship Center. Our services are online up to this point. We will keep you updated as to when we will go into the sanctuary to have services. Wednesday to Friday, 7 p.m. nightly, you could catch us. And on Sundays at 9 a.m. Our office hours have gone back to the usual time, from 10 to 5, Monday to Friday, and the business center, the copy center, TT Post, and Exousia Book and Gift Center, 9 to 5 p.m. Monday to Friday. If you have been a part of us, you would notice that Pastor Vivian has started with a special teaching, a series of teaching called The Principles and Practice of Self-Governance. Extremely important. It took me a long while to realize how important self-governance is for me to learn how to manage myself. The mistakes I would have made if I had understood self-governance, I most likely would not have made it. My eldest son, well, he's the eldest child, says we have to do everything thinking about the end first. If I think about the end result of what I say, I probably wouldn't say something. If I think about the end results of what I do, I probably would most likely will not do many things. Right? So, I mean, the principles and practices of self-governance is something that you will want to be a part of. There is a manual available. You can call 633-370 to get the manual. And if you cannot come, you can get the manual PDF. You can order the manual by visiting manual.ddwc.tv. You can also listen to me, Ask Pastor Gemma Radio on Isaac Radio 98.1 FM on Fridays at 3 p.m. So we're looking again at the question, how do I know I am really born again? Last week we read at length from John chapter 3, which you can read for yourself. And Jesus is having this conversation with a ruler of the Jews named Nicodemus. And in chapter 3 of John, verse 3, Jesus answered and said unto him, verily, verily, I say unto thee, except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of God. And Nicodemus started this conversation with him. He said, well, what do you mean? Should I go in my mother's womb another time? And Jesus said, no, you must be born of water and of the Spirit in verse 5. And last time we talked about water and of the Spirit, it includes baptism in water. And Jesus demonstrated how we should do that when he allowed himself to be baptized by John in the River Jordan. He was completely immersed in water. And so that's what they're referring to there. And then by the Spirit, this Holy Spirit now indwells us, because Jesus is no longer a physical person. He has the ability and the capacity to indwell every single person now, because he is in spirit form. And last time we looked at the very first point, we were saying there are five characteristics of somebody who is born again. And I'm taking that from an article by Dr. David Jeremiah. And the first thing he said was, you have to believe and confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. So there are certain things that must be clear. There has to be something in your personal belief system. You have to believe who Jesus said he is. You have to believe what the Bible says he is. We believe he's God. All right? We believe that he died on the cross, that God, he left his godhood in a sense, put on man as a cloak, you know, humanity, came to earth, demonstrated how we should live, died on a cross, rose again, went back, seated at the right hand of God the Father, and now he has left a pattern for us to follow, right? And so I must believe. So if I don't believe he's God, then there's not a possibility that I can accept him, because I don't believe, right? In John chapter 1, verse 12, there were many people in his time among his own people who didn't believe. It says in John chapter 1, verse 11, it says, he came unto his own, and his own received him not. But as many as received him, to them gave he power to become the sons of God, even to them that believe on his name. And so it clearly tells us in the Bible, in John chapter 1, verse 12, that to acquire sonship, to consider myself a son of God. And here we're not talking gender. I'm a human being we're talking about. So a man could be a son of God, or so kind of woman. Because it says, as long as you receive him. So I must believe, I must receive, I must accept the fact that Jesus is God, came from heaven, lived on the earth, allowed himself to be crucified, rose again from the dead, and is now seated at God's right hand. And I now must receive and believe what happened. And the Holy Spirit is now going to indwell me. Point number two, there must be a changed life. This whole belief and receiving and so on is something that you can't see. You can't see when I believe. You can't see if I receive. No, I can confess with my mouth, and you know that's fine, because I can tell you, no, I am telling you that I've been born again. So because the Bible says I must also confess Jesus Christ, right? So we are confessing, but you have to go beyond my receiving, my believing, even my confessing. And there must be a demonstration, a physical, seeable, lookable, touchable, a change in my life. This experience of being born again must be demonstrated in my life. Now, if you look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, and I want you to hold on to your Bible, because of what this is, we need to have your Bible with you, right? So that you can read for yourself what I'm saying. Take your time and study it, and you decide whether you want to accept or reject whatever I'm saying, which is fine. You know what I mean? It's okay to accept or reject what I'm saying, but at least, you know, read the Bible for yourself and see. So, 2 Corinthians 5:17, it says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things become new. Now, from the time a verse begins with therefore, and Apostle Vivian is always being very careful to teach them that, it means that there is something that came before that I need to pay attention to before I embrace therefore. I can't just take therefore on its own. And if you look at the verses before, from verse 14 says, for the love of God constrained at us, because we thus judge that if one died for all, then we're all dead, and that he died for all, and that they which live should not henceforth live unto themselves, but unto him which died for them and rose again. Wherefore, henceforth, we know man after the flesh, yea, though we have known Christ after the flesh, yet now henceforth know we him no more. So the writer was saying, all right, Jesus Christ was here in the flesh. He's no longer here. He's in spirit form. And he died and rose again. And then he says, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. And remember, we are saying, how do I know I'm really born again? And the first point is we have to believe, we have to confess, we have to receive Christ, you know, and that's a spiritual exercise, right? But then it says, there must be evidence in our lives that we have a changed life. And in 2 Corinthians, as we just read, 5:17 says, I am now a new creature, right? And it says, old things are passed away. Behold, all things have become new. So when I accept Jesus Christ as my Lord and Savior, a process begins. A process where the old is being replaced by the new. The Holy Spirit now indwells me. And my old ways, my old hateful ways, my old sinful ways, the practices that I did that didn't please God, the practices that I did that went against human beings must change. There must be a difference. If I was hateful and mean, and I now confess that I'm born again, there must be evidence that there's something changing. Now, it's progressive, and everybody would change at a different rate. So I don't really qualify to judge somebody or be critical about somebody, right? But there must be some kind of change, right? The very nature of God must begin to manifest itself within me. I must see the change. My loved ones, those who live in close quarters with me, must see that change. People who know me and who work with me, there must be that change, because there's an inside working. Something begins to happen to me from the inside. That is why people who know people who said that they are born again are baffled. I've known people who up to this point can't believe. You had this friend, and I remember this particular gentleman. He was the life of the party. I mean, he was the one who would lead in all the lines and the drinking, and he was an excessive drinker and everything. And the guys that he used to hang with, they can't believe, you know, what happened to him. Immediately, this new creature experience kicked in. His taste for alcohol went, a number of things that he would do. His language changed. I mean, he was not comfortable using profane language. In other words, his tongue started to become born again. And, you know, he couldn't even hang around his partners because, of course, they use expletives all the time. Because, I mean, that's part of some people's culture. They're not angry, they're not upset, they're not vexed with you, but they curse in you. And they laugh and so on. And as far as they're concerned, it's just good banter, right? And he just could not handle it. And so he had to kind of separate himself from them. And that created a big problem. The Bible says that when you have a born-again experience with Jesus Christ, that there's a process of all things becoming new. And that is why you're not trying to be different from anybody else. Something is happening on the inside of you, and it's demonstrating itself on the outside. And so when I say, how do I know? Because the question is, how do I know I'm really born again? Not only must I believe and confess with my mouth and receive Jesus Christ, but there must be some beginnings of change in my life. I must become a little more like Jesus. I must reflect him in speech, in my manner, in my thoughts, in my actions. I mean, everything that concerns me must change. I should be able to look at myself over the years and look back and see a different person. You know, I must become a softer, gentler person. I must become a more compassionate person. I must become a more caring person. I must become a more loving person. There must be some change. It may be slow, but it should be gradual. And people must see it, and I must also recognize it. If I, as an individual, confess that I'm born again, and there is no change at all in me, then perhaps I should revisit the experience. Go back to God, go back to the drawing board, go back to the Holy Spirit. And the truth is, I'll tell you about me, I go back to the drawing board pretty often. And I've been born again for quite a long time, very, very many, many, many years, right? And ever so often, I will go back to God and I'll say to him, you know, Holy Spirit, I should have, you know, overcome this particular thing, you know. I don't understand, because sometimes you think that you overcome something and there are certain triggers. boy. And I mean, when these triggers is, you know, we say in Trinidad, they mash your corn, and you realize, you'll see whether you're really, 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 really born again as you thought you were. And many times what comes out is not the character of God. But then we don't have to be discouraged. Just go back to the drawing board. And I have had to do that very often over the years, and I continue to do so. It's a journey, a process that will take your lifetime. This process of becoming Christ-like is a lifetime process that we're going to have to want to struggle with, go back to God, read the Bible. We have to look at the Word of God and look at the standard that God has set to see if my life is matching to the standards. I can't look at the religious dogmas. That's not enough, because the organization that I belong to may believe something and practice something, but I have to check this Bible to see, is it in here? Because I could satisfy a religious organization. I could satisfy the people around me and those who are the leaders in the organization. But then I to be born again, I must satisfy God. And God alone is really the true judge of my relationship with him. It's an internal relationship. And many times, not because somebody doesn't behave as if he or she is born again, that doesn't mean that the process didn't start, right? It just means that that person has to go back to the drawing board. And I want to encourage you, if you are here, and many times you are criticized by those who know you very well, especially family members, and you claim to be born again, and then you behave in a way that doesn't quite exemplify Christ. And sometimes you tell yourself, wow, you know, should I even bother with this? I say, yeah, you need to bother, because it's a process, right? And if your family members, those who are close to you, if they're honest and they're truthful, accept it. It may be critical in terms of how we see it, but just accept it and say, you know what, you're right. My reaction to you should not have been like that. I should not have answered you in this manner. The Bible says a soft answer turns away wrath, and I didn't quite answer you correctly. On the workplace, when we misstep, as we say, and didn't quite act, and our co-worker says, hey, I say you're a Christian, we need to say, you know, I'm sorry. You know, my behavior really didn't exemplify that. I really apologize. And go back to the drawing board, go back to God and say, you know, you have to help me with this, Holy Spirit. Because my experience is not just for me. It is for me. It is primarily for me. But remember, there are other people who I would like to influence for Christ. I want them to realize the benefits of this whole born-again experience. So the experience of being born again must affect how I think. Hallelujah. So that's something that's between God and me. It's not me, you, and God. You don't know how I'm thinking, right? So even my thoughts, I have to scrutinize. And many times, Holy Spirit has a way of just, as we say, jacking us up by thinking. You're thinking something. And, you know, you feel a sense of foreboding inside you. No, that's not how you should think. You're thinking something about somebody else, and it's a hateful thought. And you didn't say anything, because we learn how to be social creatures and not to say every single thing that jumps in our mind. And suddenly you feel a sense of unease inside of you, because you know that you shouldn't be thinking in that particular way. It affects your thinking. It affects your speech, what you see. And as I talked about the gentleman, your language will change. I can't be a cussing born again person. After a while, the cussing had to decrease and then finally cease. Because many of us, we've learned the language over the years, and it's a challenge to fully get rid of it. So what I say, I must really pay attention to how I say it too, because many times we've learned to say things and it has become a part of who we are, how we say it. But that's something that I am learning, that if how I say it offends somebody, then I should take into consideration that that person is offending. And I must try now to be different, to say it differently, because my intention is not to offend. It also affects how I act, how I behave. There must be evidence of a change in my lifestyle, by my behavior. What are the things I do? What is my philosophy of life? If I should, when I go to the workplace, you should see a difference. I must now give a fair day's work for my wages, even if I feel that the wages are inadequate. But that's what I agreed to be paid. And so I must give a fair day's work. My lifestyle must change. I may have lived a lifestyle that was contrary and contradicted the standards in the Bible. I can't be comfortable continuing in that particular lifestyle again. We're going to pick up from there. Next time we meet, remember, the question was asked, how do I know I am really born again? And we just reached point 2 out of 5, which says there must be a changed life. And that changed life must be evident in how I think, which is between God and I. There must be a change in how I act. There must be a change in how I speak. And there must be a change in my lifestyle. It's going to be a gradual change. It doesn't happen overnight. It takes us many years and maybe until you're alive, because nobody's perfect. And as long as you are living in the flesh, we'll never reach the stage of perfection. Don't forget, it's simple to be born again. If you're listening to me, just ask Jesus Christ to come into your heart, take over the management of your life, give him your past, give him your present, give him your future. Start to read the Bible. We are in the book of John. Read the book of John. And the Holy Spirit will come in as soon as you ask Jesus to take over your life and begin to direct you, even as to what church to attend, which church to go to. He is going to direct you. A pleasant good morning to you. Have you ever said to yourself, I really wish I can understand the Bible better? I read the Bible, but I simply do not understand it. I wish I knew enough to share my faith. Sometimes I sit in the pew and I don't quite understand because the pastor uses so many scriptures. If you said any of these things, today I have the answer and the solution to your problem. My name is Gemma Duncan. My husband and I are the pastors of Divine Destiny Worship Center with our headquarters in Digo Martin. And we have a program called the School of the Bible that I would like to introduce to you today. School of the Bible is a one-year program for simple, regular, ordinary people who sit in the pews, whose only desire is to understand the Bible better. Since 2014, we've catered for a wide range of persons, as young as 10 years old, and people into their 80s. So it's something that the average person can really understand and grasp. Although we cater primarily for people in the pews, we've had a few pastors who came and they felt that they should just sharpen up their information base on the Word of God. Since 2014, we've helped almost 400 persons, ranging from young to way into the 80s. The program lasts for a year. Every Tuesday from 7 to 9, we meet, and for 4 Saturdays for the entire year. Every quarter, we have what we call a quarterly assessment meeting. We also have online facilities, and we've been really blessed. We have had people from USA, Canada, Europe, the Caribbean countries, Tobago, and we actually have what we call a local online group or groups. It doesn't matter where you are, you can access School of the Bible. We have lectures, we have group reports, individual book reports, movies, training in all our presentations that we call 5-minute sermonette, PowerPoint presentations. I mean, you name it, we have it. And we cover a wide range of topics. Our main resources are the Bible and the 7 manuals. And I'm going to just quickly give you a sense of the manual. Volume 1 contains the overview of the Bible and the first 5 books of the Bible, called the books of Moses, the books of the law, or the Pentateuch. It goes from Genesis to Deuteronomy. Volume 2 are what we call the books of history, from Joshua to Esther. Volume 3 are the books of poetry, from Job to Song of Solomon. Volume 4, books of prophecy, and the books of prophecy are divided into the minor prophets, major prophets. The major prophets are from Isaiah to Daniel, minor prophets, Hosea to Malachi. When you come to the School of the Bible, you will get a further understanding as to why they are called minor and major. Shifting into the New Testament, Volume 5 are the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, John. and the one historical book, the Book of Acts. Volume number 6 are letters of Paul. They are called the Pauline epistles from Romans to Philemon. And volume number 7 are the general letters written by a variety of authors from Hebrews to Jude. And then the one book of prophecy in the New Testament, the Book of Revelation. Other resource materials are available on request. We have them there. If you wish for them, they're not compulsory. You can request them and we'll order them for you. We want to give you a little example of what some of the volumes look like. And so we have the cover page for the overview of the Bible, the cover page for the Book of Genesis, and the cover page for the comparative study of the Gospel. Call us at 633-3780 for further information. A brochure will be sent to you with all the information you will need. I'm eagerly looking forward to seeing you in School of the Bible in 2021.
This is Pastor Donald Duncan of The Body Church, and I'm excited to share with you my brand new book, The Mystery of Time, Understanding the Time and Season You Are In. God has fit time into the continuum of eternity in such a way that it governs the human experience. In this, my seventh book, I look from seven different perspectives at the age-old question, what is time? I provide scriptural best practices for discerning God's timing and share effective tools for understanding the end times. Most importantly, I reveal through the life of Jesus the value of living according to God's schedule and tapping into the wisdom of the Holy Spirit for a revelation of the future. Pick up your copy today. You won't regret it. Available now at Amazon.com.
I don't want you to ever forget what Jesus said. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father except by me. Join me next week as we continue with the question, how do I know I am really born again? God bless you real good.